Dean's early success and distinctive personal chemistry brought him back to Hollywood within 3 short years. This time as a star. Not an easy transition to make for an insecure 23-year-old. But somehow that insecurity and all the other emotions that drove Dean personally were poured with stunning impact in films like Rebel Without a Cause, which also transformed a child actress into a major new star, Natalie Wood. Natalie, all kinds of studies are coming out now about James Dean and his significance as a social rebel. You starred in that picture. So many years later, what do you think that Dean's screen image conveyed?
Well, I think the main thing that it conveyed was his need, you know, was his kind of emotional need. And I think that really he was not a rebel in the sense that he was not rejecting parents. He wasn't sort of saying, leave me alone, I don't want to have anything to do with you, I'm going to do my own thing. Mm. He was really saying, listen to me, you know, hear me, love me.
He wasn't blaming anyone, but
he was just trying to get that connection. You know, so much in Rebel, the scene where he was saying to his father, you know, he was trying to make the parents into people that, you know, he could love and into people that would help him, that would give him. It seems to me that kids today are sort of saying, it's a wrap, I'm turning on and I'm dropping out.
Yeah.
And Jimmy was really trying to fight his way through still, I think, you know.
Yeah.
In a very active way, you know, he was saying,
looking for communication.
Stand up to his dad, you know, and communication, yeah, exactly that.
Is it possible, however, that Dean blazed the trail for the Mick Jaggers, the Bob Dylans, David Bowies, even the Alice Coopers? Without one, wouldn't we have had the others?
Well, maybe not. I mean, maybe one is the, you know, it's the other side of the moon. But I think that it's interesting that at that time he had such an impact, even before his death, you know, and then certainly with his death. And now still again, all these years later. So there must be something universal in what Jimmy transmitted, you know.
He planted a big seed.
Oh, yeah.
Now, what about Dean himself in those days? What can you remember about him that made him so intriguing?
Well, again, the thing about Jimmy that strikes me now in looking back, I mean, at the time he seemed like a great nonconformist and a great rebel and an eccentric and all of that. But really, he was eccentric only, by today's standards, he wouldn't be eccentric at all, I don't think. I mean, he wouldn't wear ties, he wouldn't wear suits, he wouldn't go to social functions, he wouldn't do the Hollywood thing, you know, he wouldn't do what the studios expected him to do. But yet today, many actors don't do any of those things.
Right.
You know, most young people don't wear, you know, don't get dressed up and do all of that.
Most old people do.
Exactly. I mean, nobody does. But I think, you know, he was not into drugs or anything very spooky or weird. I think he was a very healthy young
spiritual,
man.
Spiritual, I always say.
Yes, very moody and poetic, but not freaked out or drugged out or anything like that.
Natalie, at the time, was he aware of the fact that he was becoming a cultural symbol and a star?
No, not a cultural symbol. He certainly wasn't aware of that. I don't think he was at that time, but he was very aware of the fact that he was a star. There was no escaping it. I mean, eyes were on him, and I remember when we did a television show before we did Rebel, and we used to go to lunch on his motorcycle to a nearby hamburger joint. And he used to be fascinated with the stories that were being written about him in the movie magazines, you know. A lot of them were about his love affair with Pier Angeli, and he would read them. He wouldn't buy them, but he would be fascinated, you know, and then he'd sort of, you know.
What did you think they were trash and sort of?
Well, he wouldn't really say. You know, I think he was trying to figure out, you know, or keep a part of himself to himself, and then he was trying to figure out why did they see him in this other way, or how was he being seen by others. You know?
Before Rebel, you'd been a child star and very protected, I would imagine. How did you identify with that story?
Well, it was a very important film for me personally, because up until then I had worked as a child and I had always just done as I was told. I was, you know, you do this picture next and then you do that picture next, and I was a rather dutiful child. And when my parents read the script of Rebel, they said, oh no, not this one, because this, you know, it showed parents in a rather unsympathetic light. And yet I read it, and for the first time in my life, I said, oh, wait a minute, I have to do this. I love this. You know, I love Judy, and I felt very much of a connection, identification with the part. And I guess I was going through my first rebellion.
One of the most powerful scenes in Rebel was a spectacular chicken run with Natalie, Dean, Sal Mineo, and Corey Allen, which served notice on the middle class that their alienated teenagers were a time bomb.
Hit your line!
Incredible scene. Mm. Natalie, you said earlier that James Dean was not exactly a rebel. Now, why do people respond to him today? Why do people respond to him today, if you will? What does he mean today?
Well, of course, it's hard to say, but maybe it means that the young people want that connection again. I mean, maybe the dropping out, you know, dissociating is not working. Maybe he is personifying again, you know, a return to that connecting to one person. I mean, Jimmy was very romantic, really. I mean, he loved one person. He wanted to love one girl. It was a kind of a forever kind of love that he was searching for.
You had a romantic scene with him in Rebel, which in retrospect isn't shocking, but very touching. What is it about that scene that's so touching?
Well, I suppose the tentative quality of it. I know that we both felt very embarrassed. I was only a teenager, and I'd never played a love scene before. So for me, it was the first time I'd ever played a love scene, and I guess Jimmy had played, you know, one in East of Eden, but... And he was quite embarrassed. In fact, some of the dialogue, he didn't quite, you know, didn't quite come out because he mumbled a bit.
He wasn't ready for it.
Hi.
Hi. Is this what it's like to love somebody?
I don't know.
What kind of a person do you think a girl wants?
A man?
Yes.
But a man who can be gentle and sweet.
Yeah.
Like you are.
What's
that? And someone who doesn't run away when you want them. Like being Plato's friend when nobody else liked him. That's being strong.
Oh, wow. We're not gonna be lonely anymore. Ever, ever. Not you or me.
I love somebody. All the time I've been looking for someone to love me. And now I love somebody. And it's so easy. Why is it easy now?
I don't know. It is for me too.
I love you, Jim. I really mean it.
Well, I'm